alt team. So yeah, a little bit of background on me. I've been in marketing, doing content marketing and SEO driven content marketing. I think that all SEO needs to be paired with content marketing in how modern day SEO works. I have a background in translation as well. I still translate today. So we're going to be talking about what the difference is between branded and non-branded traffic, and why exactly it is that we are targeting non-branded traffic, how that helps. We're going to be talking about how modern day SEO works. It doesn't work the same as it did back in the Wild Wild West days where you could do anything. And then we're going to actually go through a strategy for coming up with a list of topics for your blog, how to research them, and how to understand search intent. So I guess if you guys have any questions, you just drop it in the chat. I can't see the chat, so maybe we will address them at the end during the Q&A. So branded traffic, I'm gonna use an example from HubSpot here. So branded traffic is basically exactly what it sounds like. It's when people search for queries that include your brand name. So branded traffic for HubSpot, for example, would be something like how to use HubSpot, HubSpot CRM, HubSpot Academy, is HubSpot worth it, et cetera, et cetera. It's nice to have branded traffic because it does indicate that you're doing something good with your brand, that people want to find out more about you, that they want to try out your product or your service. But it also means that if you're focusing only on branded traffic, that the only people that are going to find you are people who so what's interesting with non-branded traffic is that you can find people who need a solution that you offer, but that don't know that you exist yet. So some examples of non-branded keywords would be best CRM, customer service tool. These first two have really high purchase intent. So this would be for creating kind of bottom of the funnel blog content, but you can also catch them higher up in the funnel with how can I improve my sales performance? How can I forecast my sales for a new venture? These are keywords that somebody who would be using HubSpot or could find a benefit in HubSpot, they would also use these keywords. And they might not know that HubSpot yet exists, but they would search for these things. And then HubSpot has a very extensive and active blog, and they would answer these questions. And then normally they use a kind of content upgrade to get them on the email list, et cetera. And basically they use these keywords in their blog to get people in their funnel who don't yet know about them. So it's really nice to have non-branded traffic because you can really expand your reach. But the thing about it is that you need to understand what kind of topics to write. The problem with a lot of strategies that people are creating today is they're like, okay, we need to create a blog. Everybody says that we got to create content. So let's all sit around together as marketers and come up with a bunch of topic ideas. The only problem is that these topic ideas, even if maybe they're relevant to your product, maybe they don't really, a lot of the time it's haphazard. It's not chosen in a way that's going to help solve your customer's pain points. So this makes buddy bad. And it's mostly created on a marketer's hunch. And a marketer's hunch to me is, I call that what marketers think is gonna work. Unfortunately, most marketers are not the ones who are actually talking to the customers. You have a lot of other people who are connecting with the customers, and then the customers also have their own perspective of their pain points, and they describe it in a certain way. And they describe how they would call your solution, maybe not in the same way that you would call it or how the marketer thinks it should be called. So the blog topic ideation flow looks more like defining your customer persona. So you define the customer persona, you go and you look in places they're hanging out, on forums, on Reddit, on Facebook groups, whatever it is, you actually talk to them. You talk to the people that deal with them, like sales or customer success. Everybody here, I guess, has a very small team because that's in the title of the talk. So if you're lucky, maybe you are also sales and customer success, and maybe you have a lot more touch points with the customer than a larger company would have who has an actual marketing department. But anyway, the first step is you're defining your customer persona, which needs to go beyond just this person has this job title and this level of education and they live in this location. No, they have a lot of day-to-day frustrations that they want to find the solution to via Google. And it may not directly or immediately be through looking for your product. So you define this person and their pain points. Then you're going to start coming up with ideas. Then you're going to validate the ideas with some research. And then you can start creating the content. So the main people who interact with the customer, or the main people you're going to get information about the customer from, are sales, because they talk to leads. They know which leads close better. They know what objections come up. You're going to talk to customer success, because those are people who deal with your actual customers, who talk to them every day and understand what problems they're having or how they actually use your product or service. And then you should talk to the customer themselves. And depending on what industry your company is in, you may also talk to subject matter experts, because sometimes the person creating the marketing content isn't an expert in the topic. And if you have some very technical product, it's not okay, it's not going to work to create some generic content. And by that, I mean content that's a summary of the top Google results for a topic that you came up with. So depending on what industry you're working in, you need to have all these different touch points to create content that's actually going to educate your user and take them from being unaware of something and having learned something and being able to take action on what they read. So the level of the content that you're writing needs to be at least a little bit higher than the person that you're targeting. So what questions do we actually need to ask these people? When you talk to sales, again, if you are the one that does sales, if you're the one that talks to the customers, then you can already start writing these things down right now. Otherwise, then after this, you got to go and talk to your sales department to come up with some topics. So this, either you should know this information already if you're doing the sales in your company, and if you don't, then maybe it would be an interesting practice for you to start to get this information from your sales calls, because this is going to help not only improve your sales, but also feed into the content and get to understand how to best serve your customer with your content. And the reason we're talking to sales right now and to customer success is to actually get a definition of who your best customer is, because there are different kinds of customers. And the one that you want to attract, the ones whose pain points you want to really understand, the ones whose heads you would really want to get into, are the ones that are your best customers. The ones who you're like, that's the kind of person I want to attract, the kind of person who's going to pay the most, the kind of person who's going to stay with me the longest, and the kind of person who's going to be the least pain in the ass. Excuse my French, but that's the, you want customers that aren't going to be really annoying and take up a lot of energy from you, the ones that respect you. And there's a certain type. You can go and figure out who they are. So how do you find out who your best customer is? So when you go to sales, you start to ask people, what benefit do you receive from my product or service? Beyond just the face value, beyond just what it is, what actual benefit have you received beyond the alternatives that you've tried? Have you tried any other alternatives? This is going to help you understand what thought process happens before they actually make a purchase. And maybe you can capture them earlier in that thought process. How do they describe your product? So this is really interesting, because there's a lot of people who are creating products or that are providing services that are so immersed in their industry and maybe so technical and really aren't the same target as their audience. They're living in a completely different world, that they're actually describing their product and describing the benefits, even if it ends up being the same benefit, but they're describing it in a totally different way. So it's very important for you to ask them, for example, have you ever recommended my product or service to somebody else? And if you did, how did you describe it? You can actually just take the words right out of their mouth. All of these questions need to be documented. You can't just keep it in your brain because you won't remember. So what problems were they facing before they started using your product? I particularly like asking, like, what were their day-to-day frustrations to the point where they're like, oh man, this is so annoying. I need to find a solution. So getting through that thought process, if they have had that problem, then other people have had that problems too. Again, what are their objections when you get on sales calls with them? Because if you can address those objections beforehand in your content, then that already takes away one step during the sales process and helps shorten the sales cycle, which kind of leads close the fastest, because there are probably certain job titles or company sizes or a certain kind of person that ends up closing sales more quickly. For example, if you have something really innovative, something that people haven't tried before, it's more likely that your chief of innovation is going to be really quick to want to try what you're doing rather than the head of IT. I mean, that's just an example. I don't know if that's true, but there are some certain kinds of people that will close faster. And maybe those are the kind of people that you want to start focusing your content on. And a nice question is, who's going to pay the most? What kind of clients or customers are willing to not question the price that you offer, and they see the value more? These are also the kind of people that we want to target. And this is going to help us develop the person that we're targeting. Then you want to talk to customer success. So these are people who talk to the customers you already have. So they've already converted, they were leads, now they're customers. And we want to understand what their experience is like as customers to also continue defining who our best customer is. So which customers are the least painful to deal with? You got to face it. There are some customers that, yeah, they're paying me and they're staying with me a long time, but wow, they're taking up a lot of my time and they're asking me a lot of things that I wish I didn't have to deal with. So which ones are actually really pleasant to work with? Which ones see the value in your product or your service? So this is also some more things you need to define. What features do they use the most? So a lot of products, if you're past MVP or if you have a service with multiple value-added things, which features does this best customer just love or they find the most useful? You can figure this out just by asking them. Don't be afraid to talk to your customers. Which kind of customers, this is kind of a repetition, but yeah, who make the most out of your product? Who uses it to its limit and to the point where they're like, wow, I can't live without this. I'm so glad I got this into my life because I use all of the features. So this is, again, the kinds that maybe you want to target. And what are the most common questions they ask? This may be related to your product, or maybe it's related to just the field that your product is serving. So after you've talked to these people and you've defined who the best customer is, then you're going to go and talk to the best customer themselves, because there are some questions that you need to ask them that customer success could guess, but they can't answer 100% with 100% certainty. So you're going to ask them some product related pain points, like what was your process before deciding to use our product? What is your favorite feature of the product? Again, how do you describe the product? And there's a series of questions that you can ask them, and I can send those to you guys later, but basically understanding how they view your product and how it fits into their business, if you're B2B, in their position, in their business goals, professional goals, and how it solves their day-to-day pain points. And then you also need to ask them non-product related pain points. So what are your goals 3 months from now? Who do you have to answer to? What is the most challenging thing about your job? Again, what are your day-to-day frustrations that you just can't find the answers to? Questions like these that aren't directly related to your pain points, but help you better understand who your customer is and what their lives are really like on an emotional level. Even if it's at the workplace, they still feel it on an emotional level. And this is going to help you come up with topics that are really resonating with them and to really understand. It's not only for the topics, but to really understand what kind of language to use when you're talking to them. And if you can come up with something at the beginning intro, oh, I know if you are a UX designer, you got to deal with this, blah, blah, blah. And just being able to show that you understand where they're coming from That's what's going to get them to keep reading your blog posts. And then you got to ask them about their online behavior. So that's going to be, what companies do you trust most in this sector? When you go for advice, when you're trying to understand how to solve a problem in this sector, where do you go? What social media platforms are you active on? Are you subscribed to any newsletters in this industry? If so, which ones? Which ones do you actually read? So I know that this, for some people, they're thinking, my customers are never gonna get on a call with me and answer these questions. So A, you're not gonna lose anything from trying. So you should try to talk to your best customers. If you have a good relationship with them, this is only gonna take 15 minutes of their time, and it's gonna help them, and it's gonna help you a lot. And if you can't get a hold of any of them, then you should, after you've defined who your best customer is and what their position is, you gotta find other people that are similar to them in your network. You can leverage LinkedIn for that. There's such a strong community of really generous people on there. And if you start networking with them, I'm sure you could pick the brain of somebody for 10 or 15 minutes, or send a survey. Anyway, all of these things you need to understand before you can try to come up with a single topic. So what I like to do after I've defined who this person is and I understand all of these pain points is try to find topics, like what are they actually talking about? So a lot of places you can go, Quora, for example, there's people on there who are super active asking questions. It's just a gold mine of topics around any certain industry. You can just type in a keyword and then people are asking questions and answering questions there. So some people use Quora as an actual marketing channel because you can answer questions and then leave a link to your blog post in there, kind of build your brand. But I also like to use it just to find topics to write about. So for example, I work a lot in the short-term rental industry, and most of my clients are targeting Airbnb hosts or other short-term rental operators. So it's like tech that are property management software, et cetera. And if I go into Quora, I can see somebody's asked, what are some ways I can manage my rental properties while working a full-time job? Okay, now I got a topic I can write about, because this is exactly my target. And they're asking this question. So that's some content I can come up with. Another thing is Facebook groups. There are a lot of brands that grow really fast using Facebook groups. For example, there's Lendlist, which is a cold emailing software, like a sales automation software. And they have this Facebook group called the Sales Automation Family. And there they're super engaged and they get to know people who are trying to automate sales. And they grew bootstrapped without a dime of funding from zero to $1 million in annual recurring revenue in under 2 years, in 18 months. And they did that just by creating content and by leveraging this Facebook group that they have to understand what problems people are having, who it is that actually want to automate sales. And they started chatting using Messenger to talk to these people and that way extract what kind of content they needed to create. Okay, and so if you go here in another Facebook group, you can also just find questions that people are asking. It doesn't even need to be your Facebook group that you create. You can go into other Facebook groups to find these topics. And you can also look at the comments and see how people are describing things, how people are answering their questions, and really get in the head of your target audience. So here I have some questions that you can ask your current clients, and I can send all of them to you. I have this, I don't know if you guys can see this or if this is going to work if you take a picture of it on the screen, but if you take a picture of this, then you can put your email in it and I'll send you like a bunch of questions you can ask sales and customer success and your own customers. Okay, so we've talked a lot about how to figure out who your customer is. And this is just, it sounds like a lot of work, but it needs to be done. You can't just guess what topics to write about. So we're gonna come up with topics to get it to your avatar here. And we're gonna use SEO to distribute it to them. At least that's what we're gonna talk about today, because that's what I know. There's of course, SEO is of course just a distribution channel. There are plenty of other ways to distribute content. But SEO is really powerful because A, it's non-branded traffic, so you can really optimize the blog posts that you're writing about. And it's also one of the highest converting channels because people use search engines with intent. When you're very active on social media, that's great to build your brand, but people aren't necessarily searching for you on purpose. You'll pop up, yeah, and then they'll remember you when they have the need, but create blogs that are distributed via SEO is intent. People are looking for something specific, and you can, if you can understand the intent of the searcher, then you're going to provide them with the answer, and they're going to answer in your funnel. So today we're going to talk about how to get these blog topics, well, how to figure out what blog topics to write about and how to get it to your customer using SEO. So SEO today, about 10 years ago or even less, SEO was very different from how it is today. When SEO came out, when search engines started working in the early 90s, it was the wild, wild west. If you wanted to rank, you would just work on keywords, basically. You would just pick a keyword, you could stuff it 100 times in a blog post, and you would rank for that keyword. Nothing else mattered. And then, and I think it was 2004 when Google started powering Yahoo's search engine, it said, okay, well, links are important too. You need people linking back to your website because that shows that you know what you're talking about, right? So then what people would do is just create a bunch of PBNs, they're called like private blogging networks. Some people still try to use today, but you shouldn't do that. And so they create all these other extra websites and just link back to the website, the money page, the one that they wanted to rank. So that's not the way that it works anymore. As Google was going changing the algorithm, they wanted to focus on topic authority. And their goal is to fulfill the searcher's goal. What is the searcher looking for? What problem do they want to solve? And their goal is to provide them with the most accurate and the most comprehensive content that's going to help that person finish their search journey. So today, the way that Google works as the algorithm changes is that it focuses on topic authority and search intent. So topic authority is basically how much of an expert is your website on this topic. That's why it doesn't really work as well anymore to just try to SEO optimize your static website, like your landing page or something, and not create any other content around it, because you can't establish content authority, topical authority, if you're not regularly creating content around a certain topic. And then you also have to understand search intent. So the algorithms are working hard, not only with the bots crawling and understanding, but there's actually human rankers that are going in and ranking these websites and these articles and these pieces of content to say, does this show that the author has authority in the topic? Are they an expert in this? And are they providing accurate information to the searcher? Or are they just creating content just to rank? And a lot of people get worried about these core algorithm updates and all these things that Google are doing today, but I don't think that there's anything to worry about as long as you work to just create content that's helping the user, that's in something that you are an authority about, something that you are an expert in, or that you can actually help people, and that you're not writing content just for content's sake, but that you're actually trying to take all of the angles around a certain topic and solve this comprehensive problem around a certain topic. So if you look, every time Google releases a new algorithm, they also release a blog post, or I guess probably for just their core algorithm updates. I'm not sure if they do it for every single one, because the algorithm updates all the time. But when they release a core update, they release a blog post because there's a lot of people who are like, oh my God, my traffic is just plummeting. What do I do? So they make you, they have a few questions that you should ask yourself to see, why isn't my content working better? So these are some of the questions. I've bolded these myself just to demonstrate how much importance Google gives to expertise and topical authority. So does the content present information in a way that makes you want to trust it? Blah, blah, blah. Evidence of the expertise involved, such about background of the author or the site that publishes it. So if you research the site producing the content, would you come away with an impression that it's well-trusted or widely recognized as an authority on the topic? Is this content written by an expert or enthusiast who demonstrably knows the content well? So how do you show Google and show your readers that you are this authority, that you are this widely recognized expert or that you know the topic very well. Well, the way that you do that is by creating a lot of expert content around the topic. Okay. Okay. I was going to ask for questions, but those are at the end. So there is still keywords involved, of course. You still need to do keyword research, but first you need to do your customer research. Then you got to do your topic research, at least to understand what it is that you can write about that's actually going to help the person that you're targeting. And then you're going to focus on long tail keywords. So almost half of Google searches today are four words or more because people are looking for something very specific. Some people are going to try to rank for keywords that are one or two words, which because they have super high search volume, you're like, wow, 20,000 people are searching for this term. I'm going to get so much traffic to my website. Well, no. Probably not. A, because it's going to be super competitive. You're probably never going to rank on the first page. And B, because you really just can't understand the intent of the searcher if with just one word. For example, in this screenshot, if you have the word shoes, I don't know what somebody's searching for if they're at shoes. Maybe they're looking for Wikipedia result about what is shoes or what is the history of shoes or should I wear shoes? What kind of shoes should I wear to go running, right? There's no way to really understand what the person is searching for with just one word. So, and you can't really qualify this person as a potential customer with just one word. So we're targeting longer keywords with more words that A, they'll have lower search volume, but that's okay because you are trying to get a specific kind of person. So you can't try to target everybody. So you're going to target just a smaller amount of people who are more likely to become customers. So the traffic that you do get is going to be more likely to convert because they have a more specific intent. Like in this example, you have shoes and then the more descriptive phase, the long tail keyword is red Nike men's running shoes. You can't really mess that up. If you target the keyword red Nike men's running shoes, well, that's going to be a product page for these red running shoes because somebody's trying to buy them. Or maybe they're trying to get a picture of them for something, but otherwise they're most likely trying to buy them. So I'm going to just show some examples on how to figure this all out and kind of demonstrating the difference between long tail and short tail or fat head keywords, I think they're called, and how to actually figure out the intent of the searcher. So in this example, we're going to say that your business sells courses. Could be any kind of courses. Maybe you're Coursera, I don't know. But your courses are targeting people who want to become UX designers. So I guess you're going to create a lot of content about UX design or a career in UX design. There's a lot of things that involve becoming a UX designer, right? And there's a lot of people who are freelance UX designers who maybe they don't know a lot about the sector yet. So here's an example of long tail versus fat head keywords. So if I look for just UX design, if the word that I want to rank for is UX design, which maybe some company is saying, okay, we're targeting UX designers, so we want to rank for UX design. Well, yeah, you see that there's a lot of volume here. These numbers aren't exactly, like you can scroll down and see exactly how much traffic each particular page ranking for this keyword gets. It's not exactly this, but this is a lot of volume. It's also very hard to rank for. You need 160 websites to rank for this top 10 keyword. So this metric, I don't know, maybe you don't need exactly 160 because there are a lot of other things involved, like your topic authority and the quality of your content. But in general, this is a really hard keyword to rank for. And it's also unclear who we're targeting. Because if I'm just typing in UX design, well, maybe I'm somebody looking to hire a UX designer, or maybe I'm a marketer just trying to learn about UX design, or maybe I'm somebody else. But it doesn't really mean that I'm a freelancer trying to become, I'm a professional trying to become a UX designer. That doesn't qualify me as that person. So this keyword is already really difficult to rank for. And even if I do get on the first page, which I most likely won't, I may get traffic from people who aren't interested in purchasing my product. And that's a lot of work for maybe not being able to turn that traffic into customers. So what do we do instead? Well, maybe UX design portfolio. As you see, the traffic is lower. It's still really good. It's still really high. But I think UX design portfolio, well, that's somebody who's more interested in becoming a UX designer. So how did I come up with this UX design portfolio topic? I didn't guess it, even though maybe it would be an easy one to guess. But if, let's say you're outside of this freelancer world, you're creating courses, but maybe you've never been a freelancer and you don't actually know that these freelance designers don't know how to make a portfolio and they're trying to figure out how to do it. So, oh yeah, here I just want, like, it's easier to rank for, there's a lower search volume, even though it's still really high. But anyway, so if my topic is career in UX design, where do I go to understand what these people are asking about? What are they trying to figure out? And how can I help them in their goal to build a career in UX design? So what I did is I go to UX Mastery, which is a forum, and I go into the section of career and professionalism, right? I don't remember what it was, career and education. And so we have all of these questions that people are asking. I would love some feedback, wanting to get into UX design and do it remotely. Is this a good idea? How do I make a UX portfolio? Blah, blah, blah. So I decided to choose this one, but I could have come up with all of these other topics. How to make a UX design portfolio. Some career changes to UX design. There's a lot of people who come from website design or UI design or coding or something completely that has nothing to do with it. But these people are trying to understand, how can I use my past skills to apply them to now trying to become a UX designer? We have UX expertise. Do I need coding experience? These are all questions that I got from this forum. And of course, you'd get even better questions if you follow the steps before and actually talk to the customers. But for the purpose of this presentation, I just went on a bunch of different UX design forums into the career sections to understand what they're asking their peers and how their peers are responding. So yeah, I chose this one, how to make a design a UX design portfolio. So now that I chose this topic, of course you're gonna, for each topic that you're gonna create a topical authority around a career in UX design. And then you're gonna come up with a bunch of topics around that, and that's how you're going to build topical authority to attract more UX design students to your course. So the process that I'm about to show you is one that you're gonna repeat for each blog topic that you come up with. And this is the way that you're gonna get not only more non-branded traffic, but qualified non-branded traffic that's actually gonna be way more likely to turn into sales. Okay, so we chose here how to make a UX design portfolio. So the first thing I'm gonna do is go into Google. Oh, I'm sorry that this is blurry. I did not, yeah. Anyway, so I type in UX design portfolio and I look into the Google search and it gives me already, if I just open this, and like, it gives me a bunch of suggestions. How to make a UX design portfolio, best UX design portfolio, blah, 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 blah. Then if I put a little asterisk in between some words, then it also gives me some variations. And depending on where you put the asterisk for a lot of keywords, it changes even more variations. So here you can get a lot of different ideas. And then you can also look at, you can just scroll down to the searches related to, and here you get even more ideas. And then you can also look at the people also ask. And there's a lot of questions that people are asking about this. So then, now you have a bunch of ideas. Okay, UX design portfolio. I just got like a student portfolio, design process portfolio, manager, examples, PDF, bada bing, bada boom, and so many things. So what is the actual goal of the person typing in UX design portfolio? What is it that they are trying to find? Because the intent of the searcher is very specific. And Google is sophisticated enough that now it understands what the searcher is looking for. And that's because, it has over 200 ranking factors, and a lot of them are technical as well, page speed, et cetera. But it has enough ranking factors that the top 10 results that you find are usually pretty on point to your intent. So again, here we have a lot of possible things. These can also be subheadings in the topic that you write, but we we have to kind of choose one to understand what is this piece going to be about. So I just typed it in UX design portfolio into the top 10 Google results. So we just look at what we find on Google. Here we see examples, top 20 UX designer portfolio websites. So here are some more examples. Oh, look, 9 best UX design portfolio examples, 10 inspiring. Okay, so all of these results, it was actually 7 out of 10. 7 out of the 10 results on the first page of Google, they were all UX design portfolio examples. Okay, so that was one of the choices here. We see those portfolio examples, beginner UX portfolio. Some of the results on the top 10 were also like how to create a portfolio as a beginner, but it wasn't enough as a beginner titles for me to think that that's the intent of the searcher. Sure, maybe they are a beginner, but what they're really looking for is examples that they can inspire their own portfolio on. So that's what the blog post is about. That's the searcher's intent. It's actually, you don't need to guess. It's not some secret sauce that SEOs know and that other people don't know. You can actually just go on Google and logically look what are the top 10 results and what is the main theme of all of the things that are showing up. So sometimes, like in this example, it'll be 7 out of 10 of the results are the same thing. They're all examples, examples, examples. Sometimes it'll happen that it's a mix. It's called like, I don't remember what it's called, fractional intent or something, where there'll be like 3 examples, 2 how to create a portfolio, 2 what to include in your portfolio, I don't know what. And in that case, you can kind of make a summary of them all and create the ultimate guide to creating a portfolio. But in this case, that wouldn't work because the searcher's intent is to have examples. So I hope that's clear. I have another example of how to figure out intent. So here I was looking again at this career in UX design and I saw these ones, UX expertises. Should we segment our expertises? And I was like, okay, that's interesting. Because to me, the keyword UX expertise is a little bit vaguer. I think that for the UX design portfolio ones, I could kind of just guess like, yeah, they just want to see what a portfolio looks like. So some examples would make sense. But if I'm thinking UX expertise, to me, it's not as clear. Maybe it is to some of you guys, but me being outside of the UX design industry, I was thinking, what could this person be searching for? So I could guess, I could say, well, if somebody types in UX expertise, they are looking for a UX expert to help them with something. Or maybe it's all of the different industries that you could specialize in UX. Or maybe it's all of the different skills that a UX designer needs. So I don't really know. It's not really clear to me. But is it my job to guess? No. My job is to find out, because marketing is not a guessing game. Marketing is where you can actually go and figure out the answers. So I typed in UX design expertise into Google, and we see that the top results are all skills, 9 critical skills you need, must have user experience design skills, 10 must have skills. And this is the results for UX design expertise, but actually this keyword isn't really showing up here. So we know that if I want to rank for this keyword, actually what people are trying to find is skills. So again, I hope that that's clear. And then basically for every topic that you come up with, going through the process of having understood who your customer is and then scraping all of these forums and groups, et cetera, then you, for each single topic, you have to go and understand what is the searcher's intent? Can I deliver this intent? Another thing to keep an eye out for is that not all of the search results are gonna be articles. So if you're trying to rank your blog articles and then you type in the keyword that you want it to rank for and all of the results are product pages or landing pages or things that aren't articles, well, your article isn't going to rank for it. So that's also part of the search intent, is what format are the top 10 results showing up in? Can I recreate that format? You can also even recreate the structure of the blog post. You can also recreate what's included in the top ranking blog posts. Here you have 9 critical UX skills, 14 critical UX skills, 10 skills. But why don't you combine all of them and then add a couple of extra ones, and then you have an even more unique piece. And you can also observe if they have the same format. Do they have a table of contents at the beginning? Or I don't know what. Check all of the results, check what they look like, and make something better. But don't completely recreate the wheel to where yours has nothing to do with the rest of the blog post, because they're ranking for a reason.